to the CQN Podcast, a Celtic State of Mind. I'm Paul John Dykes, and for our seventh episode, I invited Ally Begg and Matt McGlone on to the show to provide a preview of Scotland's top two clubs as we move into a new domestic season. I mentioned on last Monday's show that we'd be hearing from a bona fide rock and roll star, but our schedules have meant that this interview will need to be put back a few weeks. I can assure you, however, that this will be an interview worth waiting for. Last season, Brendan Rodgers spoke about a holy trinity when the fans, players and management come together as one. We all witnessed the spectacular results of such a phenomenon during our historic, invincible campaign where we were untouchable throughout Brendan's debut season. At Celtic Park on Wednesday night last week, a section of that support, the North Curve, was missing 900 fans after recent events resulted in them being banned for two home matches. And Kevin Graham and I discussed this at length last week. The disappointing goalless draw that was somewhat overshadowed by the Linfield debacle has set us up for a must-win game in Norway, and I have no reason to believe that Brendan Rodgers can't navigate us through the tie. The first leg followed on from the SPFL's long-awaited announcement in relation to their non-action on the back of the Supreme Court's EBT decision. The mantra of the Scottish Football Association before them is that the national game needs a good, strong Rangers. It is something that the SFA President Alan McRae reiterated on this very podcast just a few weeks ago, and he was unwavering in his blinkered and ill-advised belief. It is clear that the SPFL share this deep-rooted view. Only in Scotland could we have such a lamentable situation where the authorities are so hell-bent on achieving this aim that its benefactors are continuously treated with utter contempt. We, as supporters, are expected to believe the continuity myth, that no one can be held accountable for the collapse of a 140-year-old establishment, that no one is to blame for an unlawful scheme which deliberately hid contractual paperwork from the HMRC and the Scottish Football Authorities, that an administrative oversight allowed an ailing club to be granted registration to play in European competition despite being due payables to the HMRC, that no one brought the game into disrepute despite cheating it for over a decade, that a club is a floating entity that lays claim to titles but takes responsibility for nothing else. The people who expect us to believe and accept the preposterous hoodwink have never paid into a game of football in the 30 years that I've invested in the Scottish game. Yet, they've let down every stakeholder who has, from players to supporters to investors and shareholders. The responses from the Scottish Football Authorities are vague and at times evasive. They show a propensity not to respond directly to questions put to them, but rather to over-elaborate the responses to meet their own agenda. They show a tendency to conceptualise matters and hypothesise rather than stick to the facts that we've all witnessed. They deny their own culpability, while to some extent justify their actions by shifting blame and discrediting others. And we are spoon-fed this lie by a compliant media who have let their very profession down by failing to report accurately on the matter. Cyril Connolly once said that literature is the art of writing something that will be read twice. Journalism, what will be read once. Scottish journalism doesn't even merit that these days. I doubt we will ever know the full extent of the mischief involving David Murray, but the authorities have failed to take him or anyone else to task for bringing the Scottish game into disrepute by running an unlawful EBT scheme. This means that David Murray could hitch up at another Scottish club tomorrow and run them into the grave as well. He won't, of course, because he is no longer able to access an £800 million credit facility to make the operation a success. All I want, and I know that there are many Scottish football fans out there who share this view, is transparency, accountability and fairness. Celtic are Scottish football's cash cow, yet those looking after the Scottish game are intent on protecting any toxic carcass playing out of Ibrox. It's time to find out why. This will only be achieved by a coordinated response by the lifeblood of our game, the fans. Earlier this week, I had a dig through the radio archives to take you back to the early 90s, where fan power put into motion a chain of events that led to the power brokers of our own club being removed from office. Have a listen to the contemptuous Scottish media within this montage as they picked on the bones of our ailing club prior to Fergus McCann's takeover. Compare that approach to the non-reporting of some of the most sensational scoops in Scottish football history over the last 6 years.
Liam Brady and Celtic are sliding into the biggest crisis in the club's history, and in Scottish Football Today, read the Lisbon Lions' astonishing verdict on their old club, and their make-or-break message to Brady, and why one heartbroken Lion admits Rangers will win 9 in a row.
There is a deep recession in industry, and football is not immune to that recession. And as a major club, we find it difficult, you know, in this economic climate to bring in the extra money required, but we're no different from other clubs, and it's just reality of fact that we're living in difficult times.
So the board say they have Celtic's interests at heart. Why are they not prepared to put people who have money onto the board to help out with the obvious financial problems that we see?
Well, Kevin, can I bring you in? Have you actually been offered any substantial sums of money, either by groups or individuals?
I haven't been offered any money from any source, but what I would say is that if anyone is really interested in the welfare of Celtic Football Club, let them come and see me.
The gentleman in the yellow jersey here, yes.
The bottom line is you can blow hot air all night, no gives any answers. The bottom line is you can't do anything for Celtic. You should step aside and let folk in that are willing to invest in Celtic and take the club forward. You can't do it. Step aside and let folk in that can do it.
Yes, well, is that...
I'd like to just get back to what Michael was saying earlier on about reminding us about the 50s and 60s, which brings us to mind that Celtic fans are always resting on their laurels. We've got to be reminded we've won the European Cup, which proves that they don't even think about the future. We're supposed to be reminded of the past all the time. Fair enough, won a European Cup, but what about the next 10 years?
Well, I would hope we could do that again, and that's the success we're looking for.
How do you not just dip into your own pockets for a change? I mean, you're talking about other folk getting money and that. What have you ever put into Celtic yourself? Because I bet you've took plenty out of it.
Gentlemen, are we up in the back with the spectacles?
Hold on a minute, gentlemen. Answer the question then.
Well, okay, what have you put into the club? Are you talking about straight financial terms?
Right, what have you ever put into Celtic?
If I owned
my own PR company, I would certainly do for nothing for Celtic. Because I love Celtic.
Well,
how do you know Dave for nothing?
Okay, let him answer the question then.
I certainly am not rich like the individuals that have been discussed today, and I don't have the millions to put into Celtic. And I make no bones about that, and I don't pretend otherwise.
Very quickly, Kevin.
I think you can't give more than your life. That's all you can give for Celtic Football Club.
Matt, right in the middle here, yes?
Michael goes on about Celtic being a family club. What kind of family is it when you can't buy shares in your own family?
That point there, yes. Gentleman here, yeah, the black sweater.
Archie. It all boils down to one thing. Unfortunately, I hate to say it, but the only way we will get rid of the board is the Rangers way. 2000 gate. That is the only way it's going to happen.
Well, you're a very loyal support, Davy Proven. You've already mentioned that tonight.
Yeah, I just don't think it'll happen. Celtic haven't won the championship for nearly 5 years.
Okay.
Celtic's crowds are up this season, that says all.
And there, in fact, was the half-time whistle. And the boos from the crowd tell it all. Frankly, I think it's been a scandalous first-half performance by Celtic. And as professionals, they should be ashamed of themselves.
I'd like to say to you, in all the years I've been watching Celtic, it's the worst. I think that's
well, you're pretty warped. You're pretty warped in your views about Celtic. You're pretty twisted in them. So,
I think that's
I think a lot of Celtic supporters understand that as well.
Well, I think there's many don't, and many of them weren't here the other night when the crowd was only 12,000.
And there goes the final whistle. Rangers are yet again the Premier Division champions.
If you're a Celtic supporter, this is Fergus McCann with a message. Please read my announcement in today's Sunday Post, Sunday Mail, Sunday Times, and Scotland on Sunday.
Rangers are the biggest club in Britain. People better realise that. We used to think we're a big club. We are the biggest club now. When we made our mark in Europe, unfortunately, we didn't get the position in the seedings, which is a big disappointment. But our ambitions hold no bounds. We've said it for years. We've nearly spent all the money in the ground, and more money will become available. This will be a regular feature at Rangers. Our ambition is to go all the way.
Season ticket holder. I go to most away games, and yesterday I had a ticket and didn't go.
What would you say then to the board tonight?
Something must change. We need a change at Celtic Park.
Hello, Mr. McCann.
Hi, Finbar, how are you?
Right, I'd like to ask you, are you a Celtic man through and through? And why won't you work with Michael Kelly, who is a Celtic man through and through?
Well, I'm a Celtic man. I suppose since I've been a child, I've been a Celtic supporter, and I've been a member of the Celtic Supporters Club in the past, and in Croy, and before I went to Canada. As far as dealing with Michael Kelly is concerned, I've tried very hard to deal with him. In fact, I'd tried to deal with the board before he appeared on the board. I believe, answered all the supposed concerns that they have. Is the money there? The money is there. Are these the right people? Well, he came to me in Montreal and said, you're the right person, Fergus, so I'm here.
Frank McGuinness from Dorai. Frank, you're through to Mr. McCann.
Hello, Mr. McCann.
Frank, how are you?
I'd like you to know, and I support you 100%. I just wonder what you can do if the board maintain their present position of not discussing business with you. What can you and the rest of us do?
All right, Frank, thanks.
Well, what the board have to decide individually and as a group, as they seem to have a voting trust to protect each other, they've got to decide what is the best thing for Celtic Football Club. And if this is not the best plan, they're going to have something better. Otherwise, they're going to face people like you and face maybe an empty park every time they show up on a Saturday. That's the decision that has to be made. Celtic has to go forward because it's gone down so far. There has to be a recovery operation. There has to be a rebuilding operation. And I don't think that anyone's being fooled. You don't have to be a Philadelphia lawyer or a chartered accountant to read a balance sheet that looks as bad as Celtic's right now.
But you look at Celtic as a whole, and the board is looking at a strategy that they've had. They've been criticised on this programme from time to time,
yes,
about saying that they'll come up with a pronouncement, and they haven't yet, the final pronouncement about Campbell's lying. But you have to admit, I mean, they're not dishonourable people as far as I'm concerned. They seemingly have a long-term strategy.
I don't see those strategies right now. I see a desperation move to sell a player for half price just to keep the bank at bay. I see an empty end of the park on Wednesday night, an outrageous situation. I see a balance sheet with no money in it. I see a park to be rebuilt or replaced. And I see 5 years of disastrous results both on and off the field.
I think you're right. Whoever said it, cure Davy, there would be an injustice. But there's going to be no injustice. I was about to say there would have been an injustice if a goal had been scored. There hasn't been, and no goal scored, none in five games, and still minus two points in five games, and you.
Well, you can hear what the crowd think about Archie. This is a prolonged demonstration. There are people looking at the board of directors, people looking at the dugout. Quite simply, Celtic are now approaching that stage where they've gone about as low as they can go. Five home games, four draws, one defeat, and two goals in 7.5 hours of play at home. That's nowhere.
Anyone wishing to help Celtic should put forward the proposals to us privately and in confidence, so that they can be considered seriously. The board of directors will respond to any such approach. That is the statement. There will be a further statement after the meeting. No questions will be answered at this time.
Michael, can you give comments and suggestions about Lou McCarrie being approached as manager?
When are you going to resign?
Aye,
that's what we want to know. Why don't you just come here tomorrow? It's no matter of no coming here, it's a matter of coming here. Be here. Let them know you're here. But don't go into the game. Keep your money in your pocket. And now get them out.
While we're here.
Without him, Celtic are nothing. We're disappearing.
He's only hope. We need money, we need changes. And he's our only hope.
Lou McCarrie's taken up his new job as Celtic's manager, saying it's the high point of his career. It's been 20 years since he left Parkhead, playing his last game against Rangers, who his side is due to face on Saturday.
Ladies and gentlemen, I think this is possibly the biggest gathering I've seen. The job's been lounged for many a day, and it's only fitting that it should be Lou McCarrie comes here as the new manager.
It was an easy decision to make. The only problem was I was at a good club in England, a successful club, and you tend to get attached to football teams if you feel comfortable with them, and obviously I felt comfortable at Stoke. But the lure of obviously coming back to Celtic when I started, at the end of the day, was too much for me.
Do you see yourself dealing in the transfer market soon?
I don't know if there's any money, Roddy.
What is the offer? There is no way in the world...
They do not like the fact, though, that you want control.
That's the point. And I will not put a nickel into that club with that board of directors in control. There's no way, would you?
The board have let us down for 20 years. We're gradually in downhill. We're running out of money. We're running out of players. Stadium's a disgrace.
The Celtic board are not doing enough for this Celtic team. The team I've supported since I was a boy.
Well, I don't think this board is going to invest in Celtic. So if it takes Fergus McCann to invest in Celtic, I'll be along with the crowd and shout sack the board.
That's the only problem. Is the board. We've got to get rid of Michael Kelly and his puppets.
Don't give up. The man is over tonight. Don't give up.
I feel very sad for the fans tonight. I feel very, very strongly for them.
Do you feel your fight's over?
Well, I hope it's going. I think if this goes down tonight, it really has to be the supporters who decide. That's all you can say. There's no more that we can do.
Over the past 3 years, they've won nothing. They've gone 6 million losses, 5 million in debt, 3 managers in 3 years. How much worse does it need to get?
Now we've got supporters on the field.
Oh, dear, oh, dear.
There was an attack on John Brown. John Brown was attacked by a supporter at Maxwell. Maxwell was attacked, and I think that a supporter's been taken off the pitch in the most dramatic circumstances. And Celtic are 3 down now.
Well, I did say to you, Davey, I thought Rangers would score again in this game.
Yeah, Celtic are now chasing the game desperately. Chasing the game desperately, Archie, as fans trying to voice their opinion here. And Celtic looked so bad at the back, it's an absolute embarrassment to Lou McCarty.
Well, I have to describe the most astonishing scenes happening in the Celtic stand now. The police are trying to remove supporters, and the game goes on, and everybody in the stand around me is now looking down at the centre stand as supporters have been feuding with each other. The board remain sitting to my left, quite impassive.
I'll tell you something, Archie.
Quite some of them looking as impressive as Mount Rushmore, if you can imagine that scene. A very stony looking board. It's a fight now in front of us in
the
stand.
The police have to become involved here, Archie. There's a riot going on down here in the front stand. Missiles being thrown at the director's box, and the police have to step in and do something here.
Well, this is tragic. The game's going on, by the way, but all we're seeing in front of us is Celtic supporters fighting with each other. The police have moved in at long last, as Davey suggested.
This should have happened. I don't mean these ugly scenes. I don't mean the ugly scenes. But this should have happened at Falkirk when Celtic were knocked out of the cup in Falkirk.
Well, that's right, Archie.
Did after Berwick. They ripped the place apart.
This has been waiting to happen, Archie. Celtic fans are starting to get behind their teams, concentrating now on what is going on in the park. But as you said, this has been simmering below the surface for a long, long time. And today, seeing their side 3-0 down to Rangers is just the straw that has broken the camel's back.
What we're seeing in front of us is the story of Celtic, a club riven, a board of directors unhappy with each other, a board of directors who do not enjoy the support of all of their following, and now supporter falling out with supporter. The result, whatever it is at the end of the day, will have serious ramifications for Celtic, for Lou McCarry. He knew what he was coming into, but I don't think that even Lou McCarry believed for one moment it was as bad as this.
In the Sunday Mail this week, Celtic RIP. We report the tragic death of a once great football club. Born 1888, it died of neglect in 1994. And we reveal the inside story of the sad last chapters in this real-life football tragedy and name the guilty men. From Australia, Gerald Weisfeld tells of his dream and of the double dealing. It's exclusive only in the Sunday Mail.
Ivan, because you've long admired Celtic Football Club, and you were, quite honestly, just before we came into the studio, you were saying to me, you know, it would be a pity if Celtic were to move at all. Why? Why do you think that?
No doubt about it. Well, obviously, we're talking about one of the greatest clubs in the world, and I don't think the Celtic will be the same if they move away, you know, from Parkhead. Because Celtic is connected with the Parkhead, and the Parkhead is connected with the Celtic.
A boycott by fans at Parkhead looks to have hit hard, with thousands staying away from tonight's game against Kilmarnock. Meanwhile, there are fresh doubts about the board's plans for a super stadium.
Earlier tonight, club bosses were hoping for clarification of doubts about a £20 million cash injection for the planned stadium at Cambus Lang. There have been persistent reports that international bankers Jeffinor have denied promising cash for the scheme.
We're just having a meeting this morning to try and resolve some problems in the club and go forward, and that's the whole
idea of today's meeting.
Is it close to receivership, Mr. Kelly?
Well, they have been close. I'm sure we'll resolve that problem in time.
Do you expect them to resign, Kevin?
Well, that is up to them to decide what their future is in the club. That'll be their own decision to make.
Do you think that would be the right thing for them to do, the honourable thing for them
well,
to do?
Well, that's up for them to decide what's best for the club at this stage.
Was Celtic that close to receivership?
I would think so.
Fergus McCann packed a suitcase last night in Phoenix and headed straight away for the airport when he realised the way developments were going to get to Glasgow. He arrived shortly after 9:30 this morning. He's almost like a king in waiting, really. This is the moment he's waited many, many years for, the call to come to his team to rescue Celtic.
I'd rather talk to her. I don't make any comment just now. We'll be making some statements later, I'm sure.
Are you happy to be back?
Well, let's hope so. Let's see if we can get a solution to this problem.
Presumably this is the day you've waited for.
Well, we'll find out. We'll soon find out.
The board has just made a whole mess of things, you know. Complete farcical, the board, you know.
Do you blame the whole board?
Yes, I do. I do blame the whole board.
They've taken money off Celtic fans for years and years. And there'll be promises, canvas lying. We've got it. They've never had it. They never will have it, as far as I'm concerned. Because we don't trust them. That's the end. We just don't trust them, you know.
Do you think they were right to ask for your resignation?
I shouldn't think so.
And do you think that the company is solvent, that the company is in a good financial position?
Well, Celtic has never been in a healthy financial position over the last 2 years, but there's certainly a bright future.
Did you mislead the public and the board last Friday?
Last Friday? At the meeting you said campus long as a goer?
Of course not. I followed and delivered something that I had been asked to deliver 3 months earlier. It seemed I was the only consistent person there.
Is it still the plan of you to go ahead and have our PLC? And
I think that is by far the best answer for Celtic, yeah.
But do you think that's a likely option then?
Well, I can't say. It's for others to decide. It's always been for others to decide. That was the chosen option of a number of people.
Morning, Michael. Any comment to make?
No, I'm just going to a board meeting.
Do you intend to resign today, Michael?
I'm going to a board meeting to see what's happening.
Were you aware of the full financial situation at the club?
I'm going into a board meeting to be fully briefed and decide what to do.
To be your last day as director?
No, Flor, just need to wait and see. Just hope that there's no personal gain on the agenda. That's all I've got to say on it. Thanks
very
much.
Why have you called on Chris White and...
Just need to wait and see how the day goes.
Do you expect Mr. Smith and Mr. White to resign?
Don't have anything more to say.
He's asking you to resign. What do you feel about that?
Have you misled him about the financial situation at the club?
I'm sorry?
Have you misled him about the financial situation at the club?
Absolute nonsense.
Are you going to sell your shares?
Mr. White, are you going to resign?
Do you
intend resigning, Mr. White?
Do you have anything to say at all about the statement?
Are you going to resign, Mr. White?
Were you aware of the financial situation of the club, the full extent of it?
Have you any comment to make, Mr. White?
How do you feel about last night's announcement, Mr. White? Was the club in danger of receivership?
Is the club close to receivership?
Well, you read the papers as well as I do.
Why have you asked on Chris White and David Smith to resign?
I'm not prepared to answer that.
Do you expect Mr. Smith and Mr. White to resign?
I don't know. Your guess is as good as mine.
Would you regard it as the decent thing if they did go?
Pardon?
Would you regard it as the decent thing if he did go?
No, I'm not prepared to answer that at this point. Okay.
Why have you called on Chris White and David Smith to resign?
I'll repeat.
Can you explain that?
I'll repeat. I have nothing to say at this minute.
The power struggle for control of Celtic Football Club appears to be over this evening. Three directors are believed to have gone, and three new men are in their place.
Later, he posed for pictures with Brian Dempsey on the front steps at Parkhead, summing up his feelings as he prepared to meet the board.
The important thing today is that we've been able this morning to make sure that the financial position of the club is secure. That is the most important thing. And I'll be having some talks with the chairman just now. He's inviting me over. And hopefully we'll be able to make a more detailed statement shortly.
Today's announcement seems to have brought nothing but good cheer to the Parkhead legions.
Delighted. The best news we've had for the last 3-4 years.
Everybody's in a better mood anyways. Thinking on and on, Celtic fans maybe find each other on this. Never happened in the past. It's just good news for everybody.
A new beginning has happened today. We have new people, a new plan, a new vision, and the strength to go forward. And I can tell you that we have every intention of reaching the objective that you want, which is Celtic at the very top. My message to Celtic supporters everywhere tonight is simply this. The game is over. The Rebels have won.
I first heard of Matt McGlone when I started picking up his Once a Tin fanzine outside Celtic Park in the early 90s. Whenever I've mentioned Celts for Change to Matt, he's always quick to point out that he was only part of a wider group of supporters who were able to assist in creating that change. He never strives to take all the credit himself. Matt's endeavours thereafter saw him writing for the Celtic View, before setting up the Alternative View, which is now nearly 200 issues old. Matt has always supported me as a Celtic writer, and I took the opportunity to speak to him recently and hear his thoughts on the season ahead. In the Scottish Cup final, you and I spoke about the fairy tale of Celtic, mm-hmm. and how there's this magic. And mm-hmm. You know, when you were watching that Scottish Cup, mm-hmm. and when Roger got the ball, was that amongst the most special moments as a Celtic supporter?
Well, it's up there in maybe the top five special moments as a Celtic supporter. I'm getting on a wee bit now, so I probably remember more than most. But when that ball hit the back of that net, and it was at the Celtic end in particular, there was an adrenaline rush which is even surpasses for me scoring a goal against Rangers, and that's some adrenaline rush scoring a goal against them. But this encapsulated, that goal encapsulated the entire season, because had Celtic not won that game, the press would have said Celtic had a failure of a season. There's no doubt about it, you couldn't do the treble. Look at you couldn't do the treble. Well, we did do the treble, and that's what that goal meant. It rounded off the League Cup, the League Championship and the Scottish Cup, a great season. And, I mean, that goal must live with Tom Rogic forever. I mean, fantastic. Aberdeen kept three players, showed them down his left-hand side. I'm sure that was Derek McInnes trying to be very good tactically, not taking into account that Rogic is multi-talented and can score with his right foot as well. And, you know, three players took him down. He pulled off to the right, squeezed it in between the goal and the post. What a moment. Fantastic. What a buzz. Electrifying volts going through your body. Great.
It was incredible. And you've watched Celtic for many, many years, Matt. You've seen good and bad in terms of management. Brendan Rodgers, Tom Rogic is one of the players. Another is Stuart Armstrong. To a lesser degree, maybe McGregor, Scott Brown. These guys, he's added something to their game. He's bought well. But the squad that he already you know, that he inherited, he's managed to galvanise them. What is it about Brendan that he's able to translate onto the pitch that perhaps maybe Ronnie couldn't do?
Well, you see, I think Brendan's got a bit of the Jock scene about him, because there was players there which Jock inherited and turned them into a fantastic team. Willie Wallace was the highest signing there, £40,000. The fact that 10 came from Glasgow and 1 came from Saltcoats is unheard of in football. But he did manage to gel it together. Ronnie, I felt sorry for Ronnie in a lot of ways, because he came in from a small club, well, European-wise, but a big club in Norway, to a huge club like Celtic. And if it was you or I, we wouldn't knock it back. He did allow himself, unfortunately, to be sort of led along a wee bit by the John Park, Peter Lawwell, we'll sign this guy, that guy. The attitude at Celtic at the time is sign 8 or 9 players and you'll find 2 gems in amongst it. You know, guys like, no, I know you didn't sign, but Wanyama and Fraser Foss, I know that wasn't Ronnie's signs, but those kind of guys, you'll sign bulk amount of players and you'll get a couple of players in sale for 10, 11 million. That was Celtic's thinking at the time. Ronnie was led along by that, but I'll tell you what, Ronnie won 3 trophies in 2 years. I take my hat off to him. I think the guy, I actually know Ronnie, the guy is as honest as the day's long. He loves the club. He left without any bitterness. I know that some players let him down. There's an attitude of, well, who are you? We're Celtic. I know that for a fact. But he left there with his head held high, and he said recently that being at Celtic is a once-in-a-lifetime experience, and there's something very special about this club. And I really hope, I wish Ronnie all the best in over Norway. Apparently he's doing quite well in the teams anyway, outside chance of winning the championship. But I think some players at Celtic looked at Ronnie and sort of said, well, you need to prove yourself here. But when Brendan walked in, it was complete opposite, because he has proved himself and he is the gaffer from day one. So I think that shifted some of the mentality of respect, if you want. You know, you respect a guy like Brendan, but you might, some players might have thought, well, Ronnie has to win our respect. And I think that's where that gelling comes in, that you have to up your game, because this manager demands that you up your game. There's no doubt about that. I don't think Scott Brown chucked playing for Scotland just because he thought he wasn't doing it anymore. I think he was probably told that Brendan respects him as captain of Celtic, and you will always be captain of Celtic, but you have to totally focus on the club, because, you know, years are maybe not on your side. Eloy's still relatively young in football terms. And I think that Scott has had one magnificent season for Celtic, a true captain, an absolute Goliath of a captain. Captain for me in the Roy Aitken mould and the Billy McNeil mould. And, you know, to be up there with that kind of thing is something very special.
It was the perfect season, Matt, last year. What does Brendan do going into the new campaign, and what do you think he can do in terms of progressing here?
Well, I think that we're far better prepared this year. This time last year, we were facing the Lincoln Red Imps with a team who were disorganised, who didn't know which way the manager wanted them to play. They didn't know the system. It was early in the season. So this year, if you fast forward 12 months, you've got a team who have a particular style. They have this confidence that if there's a goal down, they'll get a goal back, and they won't be beaten. Like Brendan mentioned that in the pre-season tour there. We were one down, and then we got a goal back, and we were never going to lose the game. We didn't have that last year. This team have a belief, but they also have a particular style. Brendan will say, Kieran Tierney, this is the way I want you to play. That's the way I want you to play. Stuart Armstrong, that's the way I want you to play. I want you to play. Now, Jock Steen and Martin O'Neill did that. They specifically took players aside and told them to play a certain role. You remember back at the start of the season, Brendan wasn't happy with Craig Gordon, and he put Doris DeFries in. And because Craig wasn't playing the ball out the way that Brendan demanded he do it, so he dropped him. He just dropped him. Dropped the Scottish international goalkeeper, and we all thought that might be the end of the day. When Craig got his head together and decided that this is the way that Brendan wants me to play, he became a far better player. He became a far better team player. He was in unison with everybody else. That's what Brendan brings. He brings unison, and there is great togetherness with the Celtic team just now. No matter who Celtic play, you were talking about Europe there, Celtic will be a much harder team to beat this year. Much harder team. There certainly won't be any drubbins like 7-0 that we had against Barcelona. We're a bit disjointed that night, and there's players that played in that game that are not at the club anymore. Celtic are now a very thrusting, fast-moving unit who, as you saw yesterday, are scoring from all areas of the park.
Where do you think we can strengthen? Do you think we need to strengthen some areas of the defence?
I think centre-back, I think we're okay for full-backs. I think centre-back, particularly with Boyata injured just now, there could be a wee problem there. Because we don't, apart from Simonovic and Shevchenko, we don't have anybody else. You get one of those players injured, you might have to be drafting in Lustig from full-back into centre-back. So I think we might be looking there. But, I mean, I would never second-guess Brendan. There's been years in the past you sort of hear rumours that players were signing for Celtic were after that players. Players are appearing now that a lot of us wouldn't have known were on Brendan's radar. Brendan keeps his cards very close to his chest. I've always said Celtic should do their business in the middle of the night when nobody knows what's happening. I think that's what they're doing just now. So I would think maybe centre-back, but how could you pick holes in a team that have just given us our most magnificent year? That's the thing. Some people say to me on Twitter, well, I'm concerned, Matt, we haven't signed any. I say, well, why is that? We've just seen the best Celtic team for a long, long time. Where would you pick a holder? So it's not about quantity, it's about quality. And I think that Brendan is looking at quality. And he's obviously looking on the side of youth. The last couple of signs have been the side of youth. And looking at the future, because nobody, you know, it's going to last forever. A wee bit surprised that Stuart Armstrong seems to be thinking his future can lie outside Celtic Park. A wee bit surprised at that. I thought maybe Stuart was a bit of a homebird and he'd maybe want at least another 2 or 3 years at Celtic. But I do understand that every footballer can't test himself in Scotland. In saying that, Billy McNeil played in Scotland his entire life. The legend that's Paul McStay played in Scotland all his life. Scott Brown has played in Scotland all his life. So hopefully Brendan, I'm sure he is saying to these people, Yeah, it is great down in England. It is fantastic in different leagues, and you play against a far greater quality of player. But you're at Celtic, and special things happen here. Special things do happen at Celtic. There's no shadow of a doubt, and you're obviously a great chance of playing in Europe. Stuart Armstrong could probably go to Stoke tomorrow and get £10,000 a week extra at Stoke. Now, I have to ask you, I mean, he's got enough money to get by for the rest of his life. Why do you want to go to somebody like Stoke? Not picking on them in particular, but of that ilk, because I don't think Stuart would be going to Liverpool or Man United or Arsenal or Man City. So I think you've got to look out with that. Hopefully Celtic have been fair with him, offering him a really good deal. I'm sure they will. I'm not giving up hope that Stuart won't. I'm not giving up hope that he won't sign. Hopefully he will sign. But maybe Brendan's bringing, you know, players in just now who maybe will fill in a hole where players might be leaving. I'd hate to think that. I remember when Kenny Dalglish left, I was nearly in tears. £440,000, that figure has never out of my head. And I'd hate to think Kieran Tierney would be leaving, not for at least 4 years. Fantastic player, great attitude, great moral attitude. Looks after himself off the park, still lives with his parents, does all the old-fashioned things which will keep him steady and grounded. So whatever player you're to sell, I'd like to think that Kieran would be the last person at the club.
Future captain, Mark.
Oh, definitely, without a doubt. He's so unassuming. The guy is so unassuming. And, you know, he never overdoes it or anything. He plays the game, and for a boy of his height and stature, he's not the biggest, broadest person in the world, but by God, he can put a tackle in. You've seen him challenging. And for me, what typifies, you're talking about the magic of Celtic, leaving hospital, the car stopped at the top of the road in Cathcart Road. He ran down through Aberdeen fans in his Celtic strip with his boots on, ran through them. They must have thought, what's this? You know, he's buzzing by, runs right through up the steps, through the front door, grabs a cup just at the last minute, pulls the jersey out, holds the cup out right, kisses the jersey. Now, we've seen players, foreign players, kissing jerseys in the past. That comes and goes with me. I just know how you're playing to the fans. But see, with somebody like Kieran Tierney, that's from the soul, not the heart, from the soul. And I just thought it was like Roy the Rover stuff. It was something you'd read in a comic. Unbelievable. What a fantastic player, and a great example to younger fans or young boys who want to maybe make a footballer a career.
Matt McGlone there, a purveyor of the Celts for Change movement, who feels that the supporters can force change again. As a kid growing up, one of the LPs that stood out from my old man's collection was The Rise and Fall of Ziggy Stardust and the Spiders from Mars. 5 years after his landmark album, David Bowie released Heroes, and the lyrics to the title track seem to echo the times we are living in within Scottish football. Here, for Matt McGlone, is Heroes by David Bowie.
You will be queen. last for one day. We can be heroes forever and ever. What you say? Can swim. Though nothing, nothing will keep us together. We can beat them forever and ever. Oh, we can be heroes just for one day.
Managed to secure an interview with another band member. Former Bad Boys Inc. boy band starlet Ally Begg is better known for his work as a sports broadcaster and producer. I caught up with the former Celtic TV presenter and avid Aberdeen fan to discuss Celtic's closest challenges. So first of all, we'll talk about the football. And last season, it was quite clear to anyone, any observer of Scottish football, that Aberdeen were the main challengers, and especially, you know, on that one match basis in the Scottish Cup final, they showed how much of a challenge they did give Celtic, despite the end result being a huge gap in terms of the league position and the points accrued. So if you review last season, what's your kind of thoughts on Aberdeen and their progress under Derek McInnes?
I think we've progressed season on season. I've just written a column for Aberdeen's matchday programme for the Europa League game, looking back on the cup final, and I was my sense of the occasion was I just came away feeling incredibly proud despite the defeat. I thought we gave Celtic probably the best game that we could have given them. I don't think Celtic were prepared for the type of game that we were going to give them. I think a huge amount of credit should go to Derek, the Doc, the backroom staff, and especially the players for the way they performed on the day, because I thought it was courageous. Obviously, we went in as huge underdogs into the game, and everybody felt it was going to be a walkover, and everyone was concerned. I was concerned that we were going to put in the same type of performance as we did in the League Cup final.
Yeah.
But I felt that there was a genuine concern about that we have to do ourselves justice. Aberdeen didn't do themselves any sort of justice in the League Cup final. They didn't do themselves justice, the players, and they didn't do the fans justice, more important. You know, the fans backed them to the till and paid the money to go down to the cup final, invested in the team, invested their own time to get down to Hampden to support the boys on, and we just never turned up. So I felt that the boys almost had to right a wrong, and I thought they did that impeccably. Mm-hmm. And I thought the fans came away, yes, it was hugely disappointed in the manner that we lost the game. You know, with 30 seconds to go, trust me, it was heartbreaking.
I bet.
But, you know, as we walked out the stadium, my brother and I, you know, I my head was held high. My chest was puffed out because I was proud. I was really, really proud of the boys. And I honestly don't think we could have played better. I think it's fine margins. One better placed pass from Johnny Hayes to Kenny McLean. Who knows what could have happened on the day. But I just thought it was a phenomenal performance. And I really hope that it gave them hope. And I hope it gave them belief going into the coming campaign.
Yeah, yeah. You know, the way that they came out the traps in that Scottish Cup final really had Celtic on their back foot. And as you say, domestically, you know, it was the biggest challenge we had all season. And I remember looking back on it now and thinking, well, you know, I thought Patrick Roberts was the guy really who started to take a hold of the game, maybe an hour into the game. And that was only when I started feeling a wee bit more confident, because up until that point, Aberdeen, the way they played that day, as you say, you'd have been, you know, thinking to yourself, we might just do this. And you almost did. Now, there'll be no mixed emotions, even though you had some time at Celtic Park, but do you also keep an eye on Celtic, obviously, within your current position as well? And how impressed have you been with Brendan Rodgers since he's come up to Scotland?
Oh, hugely impressed. He's given you your fire back. Mm-hmm. You know, he obviously went through a sort of a transitional season with Ronnie Dyler and John Collins, and that was the season where I really genuinely believed that we could have taken you further than what we actually did.
Yeah.
And I was disappointed that season. You know, again, we progressed and we were playing some good stuff. We bought in some good players. We were playing good football. But there was this monkey on our back where if Celtic dropped points, we went into the next game knowing that we could close the gap on you, that we could put pressure on you.
Yes.
And I lost count how many times we failed to do that throughout that season. And it was our undoing. And in the end, you know, Celtic cruised away with the championship, but it should have been a hell of a lot closer. Yes, I think it went down to the split, didn't it? I think there was a few games left before Celtic wrapped it up. But that was our one big chance to really take you all the way, to take you right to the last game, and you never know, to maybe even have won it. Because if we had taken those points in games which we should have won, where we dropped points against your Dundees and your St Johnstons, it was hugely frustrating, and you could sense the frustration amongst the fans that season, because I genuinely believe it was our one big chance. And I was always trying to work out, what's going wrong here? Why are we lacking in a big game mentality? What's wrong with the boys going into these games knowing that if they gain maximum points, we're closing the gap?
Yeah.
And we're closing the gap significantly to make Celtic nervous. And what I wanted the boys to do was I wanted them to put enough pressure on Celtic to see how Celtic coped with that pressure.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because Celtic have not been under that sort of pressure domestically for many, many years. And I was intrigued to see how they would handle it. So, you know, I was going into these games thinking, come on, boys, just get the points, get them on the board, and let's see where it takes us. You know, obviously hindsight's a wonderful thing, and we'll never know what would have happened. But it became a bugbear, and it was hugely frustrating that we were just never able to get over the line in the games that we should have won fairly comfortably, let's be honest.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, that was our one big chance. But since Brendan Rodgers has come in, it's a completely different team. You're playing a completely different style of football. You've invested heavily in players, you know, who are, you know, your Scott Sinclairs of this world, and bringing Patrick Roberts on loan. They're different gravy. They really are. So financially, you know, we all know that Aberdeen can't compete with Celtic. But my argument always is, on the park, it's 11 against 11. And it's ability against ability and capability against capability. And on any given day, I genuinely believe that we can match Celtic on their day as long as the boys have the belief and the attitude going into the game. And I think we showed that in the cup final. So, you know, obviously Celtic have invested again this season.
Yeah.
We've invested well. You know, we've bought, I think personally, we've bought very, very well. Because at one point it was all, you know, the mix of emotions in the weeks after the cup final was just incredible. And at one point, you know, it looked like we were losing the manager.
Mm-hmm.
Niall left. Johnny left, which was a big one. Ryan Jack, I'm not overly bothered about leaving. I'm more bothered in the way that he left.
Yes.
I'm not overly bothered about him going, to be honest. It was just the way he did it. And losing Big Ash Taylor, you know, the jury was always out for me in Big Ash. On his day, he was a pretty decent defender, but he was too car crash for me. So am I bothered about losing him? If you're going to put a gun to my head, not really. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't want to do the boy a disservice or be disrespectful to him, but, you know, we've got Anthony O'Connor, we've got Mark Reynolds, and I'm hoping that they will find themselves in a good partnership this coming season, tighten up the defence, you know, just see where it takes us. So, but it's all going to be about how we play on the day against Celtic, as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah.
And that will define our season.
Sure. I mean, I was going to ask that actually, Ally, from a fan's perspective, when you've done so well last season, because again, as you say, you're up against this Celtic juggernaut. Any other, you know, of the previous two seasons, it might have been different against a different Celtic side with a different kind of mettle. When you've had such a good season and then it looks as though the team is fragmenting, it must have been a real sense of frustration. Because we've seen it before, you know, even when St Johnston won a trophy, and almost the first thing that happens is, you know, they sell their star man, Stevie May, and they've never really replaced them. But what I found is, obviously, with McInnes staying was the big one, but he's recruited so, so well. I mean, do you believe going into the new season that Aberdeen will again be the main challengers? And, you know, it's up to everyone else to chase Aberdeen before they even think about Celtic.
Yeah, absolutely, 100%. I am quietly optimistic about the coming season.
Mm-hmm.
We've played a couple of friendly games. Okay, you can't read too much into friendly games. They're just bounce games, as far as I'm concerned. But we've played some decent football. The boys seem to have gelled well together. The new signings have come in. Okay, they're finding match fitness, but they've done well. From what I understand, some of the lads are absolutely on fire in training. I still don't think we're done yet with our business. I still think there'll be a couple of more players to come in. I'm really hoping we get the Sean Maloney deal over the line sooner rather than later so that we can get him up to speed, so we can get him up to full match fitness before the start of the season. As in, you know, obviously he's not going to be able to play in the Europa League qualifiers, and he wouldn't have been able to play in the qualifiers anyway. But I'm hoping he's going to be fit for the start of the domestic campaign if we get him in. So, as I said, I'm quietly optimistic. For me, the ambitions this year is to close close the gap on Celtic, not make it such a huge points difference,
mm-hmm.
and to win a cup. That's what I want this year. To get over the line in a cup final. That's what I want. You know, the last time we won a cup was 2014. Obviously, we got to two finals last year.
Yeah.
Hugely disappointed the way that we lost both of them. But just get the cup. Just, you know, we're not going to win the league. I think, you know, I'd be mental to say that we could win the league. We won't win the league. But I just want us to close the gap and do ourselves justice. If we can do ourselves justice, I think you'll find that most Aberdeen fans will be content.
Yeah.
And the other ambition that I have is I really want the boys to make the Europa League group stage. As hard as that's going to be, because there'll be some very tough games on the way, if we can make the Europa League group stage, for me, that's like winning a trophy, and mm-hmm. I'll take that.
Mm-hmm. And I think as well, with a disappointment, if you're looking at it from a neutral's point of view, looking at to the benefit of Scottish football, obviously the results so far have been very disappointing in Europe, and it would be fantastic for the whole game if Aberdeen were to progress to that kind of stage as well, Ali. And I echo those sentiments because, you know, it benefits all Scottish clubs in Europe if other ones are you know, building up that coefficient, if you like. Again, we've seen a lot of them, and you know, I had a discussion a couple of weeks ago regarding the best player out with the Celtic squad within Scotland, and me and my compadre were both in agreement that Johnny Hayes was that man. What can we expect to see from him this season?
I'm hoping not a great deal.
Not Petrodre anyway.
I'm hoping he's going to be warming the bench most games.
Yeah.
No, I'm only kidding on. Listen, he's a phenomenal player. He's a great lad. And he'll just offer you a different dimension. He's just going to offer you the strength and depth that maybe that side of the park you were lacking.
Mm-hmm.
He's the type of player that he just loves to get on the ball and just run directly at his opposing opponent. I think I wrote about it a few days ago that I can't really remember a player in the same ilk as him that's played for Aberdeen for many years. And the last one that I can really think of off the top of my head that I can put in the same category is Joe Miller.
Yeah.
It's just that devastating pace that he runs at defenders with. You know, he's skillful on the ball. He's got a good final pass on him. He can sometimes be a wee bit guilty of going missing. There was a few occasions last season that I felt that he went missing in games when we really needed him to get on the ball, get down the flanks, get the balls in, get the early balls into the box. You know, the League Cup final is a perfect example where he was just missing the whole game. And it's not like Johnny to be like that. And I always found if Johnny and Niall were missing in our games, then we weren't at the races at all. And I think, you know, the pace and the skill down both flanks last season attributed to you know, what was a very, very decent campaign. So that's the type of player you're going to get, really. And I think he'll do well. Listen, he's already up and running. He scored a nice goal against Shamrock, didn't he? So he's up and running, and I have no doubt that he'll be a very good acquisition. You know, and Johnny went with our best wishes. He really did, because he was a fantastic player, and I love the fact that he turned down Cardiff. He signed a new deal for us, possibly knowing that he was going to be on his way anyway, to make sure that we got a transfer fee for him. We put some kitty, we put some funds in the kitty,
mm-hmm.
and you know, that's enabled us now to possibly go out and buy some good talent, which will strengthen our own squad. And it was also the way he went about it. You know, it was class, as far as I was concerned.
Yeah.
He put out a nice statement, and any shirts that were sold with his name on, you know, he wanted to make sure, you know, all the money that was raised through that went to charity, an Aberdeen charity, which was absolute class. So he went with our best wishes.
Oh, absolutely. You know, and really when you compare that to the other player we've mentioned, Jack going to Ibrox, it was night and day. And again, the big thing as a Celtic supporter is we look at some of these players coming in and you always believe that perhaps Brendan Rodgers will give them another 5% to his game. You know, he seems to have that ability as a manager to man-manage and to get that wee bit extra. And I think you probably saw that more with Stuart Armstrong last season than anyone else, the way that his game really came to the fore and he became a really influential figure. What is it that Brendan Rodgers has got that he's able to tap into the mindset and the mentality of these guys, Ali, and get that wee bit extra out of them?
I just think it's his man management skills, I really do. Anyone that I've spoken to about him always mention how good he is as a man manager. First and foremost, he's obviously an excellent coach, and he's had the perfect grounding. You know, he was so close to winning the Premier League with Liverpool after so many years, just to fall away at the final hurdle. And I think coming to Celtic was the right move for him. I really do. A lot of people questioned why he was coming to Celtic, lack of ambition, coming to an easy league, taking an easy option. I think that was a load of nonsense. Coming to one of the biggest clubs in the world, why on earth wouldn't he take the job? He was actually out here for a while. He came out and worked with us as a pundit on our Premier League coverage. Right. And I found him incredibly charming. And I really enjoyed, you know, I wasn't in his company a great deal, but whenever I was in his company, I thoroughly enjoyed it. I found him a fascinating man to talk to. What I also found very impressive, even as a pundit, he was doing his research. You know, he came in, he sat in our green room, in our VIP room, and he had his head in his notes. He was reading stories from the newspapers, so that he was versed on the topic he was away to talk about on our Premier League shows. Now, I found that hugely impressive. So if he's taking that into just working in television, then God knows what he's doing when it comes to his proper job.
Yeah,
I just hear nothing but good things about him, and you know, he's just galvanised the whole club, hasn't he? And I think that, I must admit, I was hugely impressed with the way he went about preparations for the cup final as well. Just wee things like the notes that he left in the players' lockers from their families. I remember seeing a video a wee while ago, and the name of the team completely escapes me. I think it was an Italian team. And the coach, they had to go into like a game right at the death to save themselves from relegation. You have to forgive me because I can't remember the name of the team. But I saw the clip, and it was basically a coach who had made a set of videos from the players' families who had all sent quite emotional messages to all the players. And all the players were quite visibly emotional about receiving all these videos from their loved ones. And it galvanised them, and it inspired them. And they went out and they won the game and they saved themselves from relegation. And that's always kind of stayed with me. And it's just little touches like that which I think can make all the difference to players. Because we have to remember, football players aren't robots. You know, they're human beings with emotions just like you and I. And sometimes, you know, if you've got family is the most important thing. Forget football. Forget work. Family is the most important thing to you. You know, I've got two small children and my wife, and they are, above all, the most important element in my life. I love my job. My career is hugely important to me. But it's not in the different grade as my family. So when Brendan put these wee messages, or organised for these wee messages to be put in the lot, I thought that was inspirational. And maybe it just gave them that extra spare to do well. Maybe it just gave them that extra incentive to do well. Because maybe, just maybe, that wee note that Tom Rogic received from his family gave him that extra burst of energy in the last 30 seconds to go around two Aberdeen players and slot the ball into Joe Lewis. Who knows?
I know. It's so inspirational, actually. And as you say, it's all about tapping into these players' psyche and mentality. And if it does give them that extra burst of speed in the last 30 seconds, then absolutely outstanding piece of management, you know. I've been reading his notes the pre-season Celtic View. I've been reading Brendan Rodgers' notes, and he's quite clearly looking to progress on a European level, which is going to be difficult when you look at some of the factors. I always look at Celtic compared with the rest of Scottish football being quite similar to Celtic then going into the European arena, and obviously the step up is even bigger. So what can he do? I mean, obviously he's very shrewd in the transfer market, and I think when he buys a player like Johnny Hayes, he can add that wee bit extra onto him as well. What can he do? Can he have a better campaign this season? Because I believe he was, you know, certain players were still finding their feet, certainly in the early rounds of Europe last season.
It's a tough one, because as much as the manager can prepare the boys for the battle, I think it's down to the players. Management can only do so much. They can only research so much. They can show players so many videos. They can give them analytical stuff to look at. They can give them notes to read. Managers are always fully prepared, I think, coming into a game. I think it's down to the players. It's what the players do on the park that determines what will happen, what the outcome will be. And it's how the players handle the situation and handle the occasion. You know, I produced a lot of Celtics games last season in the Champions League. And I have to say, I was hugely impressed. Yeah, the game, listen, the game against Barcelona was a one-off. Mm-hmm. It's just a different calibre of player that they're up against that they're never going to face week in, week out in the Scottish Premiership. But it's how the players handle the occasion, I think. And Celtic didn't do themselves any justice. They capitulated against Barcelona. Now, can a manager do anything about that? I don't know. I don't think he can. I think it's down to the players to galvanise themselves, to lift themselves, to stick to the game plan. You know, the manager can encourage them from the sidelines and give gentle reminders about what they should be doing, but you know, I'm fear of repeating myself, it's down to the players. Mm-hmm. So I'm fully expecting Celtic to possibly do better this season in the Champions League. They need to do better, I think. I think that the fans will demand it. You know, we saw a couple of cracking games last season where I just thought Celtic were outstanding. The Man City game at Celtic Park, it was one of the best games of the campaign, and it was an absolute privilege to produce the game. It really was. It gave me so many talking points for my studio guests to talk about. So if they can replicate that kind of performance, obviously with maybe an extra 10-20%, then who knows what's going to happen.
Mm-hmm. And I think, again, Ali, you know, looking at these games, these are the games that we hear an awful lot from other areas of the media about how bad the Scottish game is, you know. And some of these European results in the last couple of weeks do nothing to support our view here in Scotland that, you know, we're maybe not all that bad. You know, you're selling it to a different audience. How difficult a sell is the Scottish game these days?
Listen, I'm not going to lie to you. It's not easy. You know, we have the rights to the Scottish Premiership in the Middle East and North Africa, and we also have it in Australia. So when I produce the Scottish Premiership games, now most of the games that I produce, like studio games, studio-based games, is obviously Celtic against Rangers, Aberdeen against Celtic, Aberdeen against Rangers. It's predominantly the teams that are deemed as being the big sides in Scotland. Mm-hmm. So, and it is rare, I've got to be honest, it is rare that we do full studio productions round most games, because we don't, because one, we just don't have the resources, plus two, it's better if we just put the games straight to air, basically when you go straight to kick-off, because there isn't really a demand for a studio show to go around with the greatest respect a Hearts v Motherwell game. Mm-hmm. So we predominantly stick to Celtic against Rangers, Aberdeen Rangers, Aberdeen Celtic, Hearts Hibs maybe this season, but you know, it's received well. From what I understand, we get favourable viewing figures for the big games. I don't know what the viewing figures are for the other games. I really don't. So, but listen, you know, I do everything that I can to push the Scottish game. You know, I'm quite active on social media with it, and I always try and lift the image of the game here in Scotland. Mm-hmm. I always try and push to do more live studio games, to try and do the game justice here. I believe we should be doing Celtic's Champions League games again this season. It depends, obviously, who we're up against, because in this region, Real Madrid and Barcelona are by far the biggest supported clubs out here, and they will always take preference over anybody else, even a Manchester United, an Arsenal, or a Liverpool, or a Bayern Munich. So that's just the nature of the beast in this part of the world. But listen, you know, I'll always push the game as hard as I can. It's a privilege to work on. I love working on it. You know, it's fantastic for me. It's fantastic for my career. It's always what I've wanted to do, is work on the Scottish game, and it's exactly what I'm doing. So, and I always try and do my studio shows the absolute justice that I think it deserves, and I always try and make the productions as best as I possibly can, so that the viewer, one, enjoys the show, two, enjoys the game, and three, comes away thinking, you know what, I actually quite enjoyed that, and I'm going to tune in more, you know? And the Scottish game maybe is getting a bit of a disservice, and I thoroughly enjoyed that game, and I'm going to watch again, you know? So for me, it's all about education, because I personally think there's a lot of naivety about our game. I think there's a lot of skullduggery about our game. I think there's unnecessary slagging of our game from people who are naive, who are uneducated about our game, and are just out there maybe to boost their social media account. And I think it's unnecessary and I think it's unfair, because I think our game really does get a disservice. And, you know, I'm always intrigued to see, you know, the attendances. And there's a guy on Twitter that I follow quite closely who always tweets the average attendance per capita. And
yes,
the Scottish Premiership is always number one in Europe.
Yeah,
and
it's very interesting.
It's something, and it's something we should be hugely proud of. And it's something I think, personally, the SPFL as a company, you know, should be banging on about and should be shouting from the rooftops.
No, you're right.
Because it's something to be hugely proud of, I think. And it's testament to the fans, not just of Celtic and Rangers, but to every club. You know, look at Hearts, look at the amount of season tickets they've sold this season. It's commendable. And I stand up and applaud them. And fair play to the fans that stick by their clubs week in, week out, and spend their hard-earned cash going to the games to support their teams. So, you know, we can all do our bit on social media, you know, those that have got a wee bit of influence and a wee bit of a profile. But I'll always do my very best to uphold the image of our game, because I love it. I absolutely love it, and I'm hugely proud of it.
From one musical bad boy to another, and Sean William Ryder, Sean re-emerged like a phoenix from the flames after the demise of legendary Manchester gang, the Happy Mondays, to form Black Grape in the mid-90s. Black Grape have reformed, but will do well to recreate the rap-infused madness of the debut LP, It's Great When You're Straight. Thank you all for playing and downloading the first 7 podcasts. We have some outstanding guests lined up for future episodes of A Celtic State of Mind, and we'll keep you informed via Twitter at Paul Dykes or at CQN Magazine. In the meantime, here are Black Grape with Kelly's Heroes.
Sexy, beautiful women.
Christ almighty.
missing like.